Let's try that one more time. Good morning.
Good morning.
Great. Isn't it great to be in the house of the Lord? We're here and we're in the Thanksgiving season, and it's just beautiful. We've got the cool weather to go with it, and we have these lovely flowers here that were given today by the adult choir in honor of Josh Hamrick and memory of all the past choir members that are no longer with us. And so they are just beautiful. They set the mood for the Thanksgiving season. It is definitely a season to be thankful for. I would prefer a little warmer weather, but I don't get all of my preferences. So, but it is good to be here today. It's good to see each and every one of you here. I do see some visitors here, and there should be some cards in the back of the pew. And if you would be willing to take one of those, fill it out, and then when we come by with the offering plate, just put them in the offering plate. And even for our regular members, if you have a prayer request, be sure to write your name on there, and we'll be glad to pray for you. We look forward to serving with you this morning. I'm sure that there is a special message that the good Lord has laid on Pastor Jason's heart, and that he will provide that for us, and we can take that message with us. And but we also we are having a meal after the service this morning, and some of you may have forgotten. Even if you've forgotten to bring something, please come eat with us. Visitors also, it doesn't matter if you fail to bring anything, we will have plenty. The Lord will provide for us. And we will have plenty, so we would love for each and every one of you that are here this morning to come over and to enjoy a Thanksgiving meal with us after the service. So I'm going to say a prayer here, and then we will get into our service. And we bow. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for this opportunity to be in your house, Lord. There's no better time than when we get to serve you, Lord. We get to praise you, and you provide for us, Lord, and for that we are very thankful that we are in the Thanksgiving season, Lord, and we ask that you just impress upon each and every one of us to have a very thankful heart, Lord, and to thank each and every thing that you do for us. Thank you for it, Lord. Praise you for it. And, Lord, just to be thankful for the things that we have in our life and our friends, our family, Lord. We just want to be able to stress upon them that we love them, Lord, and we need them in our lives, and we're thankful that you provided them for us, Lord. Just be with this congregation as we hear this message this morning, Lord. Just place it upon our heart and allow us to leave here and take that word with us and to enjoy the meal that'll be provided this right after this service, Lord. We just love you, we praise you, and we give you all the glory. These things I ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Let's stand and worship together.
I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory! My Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me. His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, he then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is
Amen. You may be seated. You're done. In just a few moments, we have a guest worship leader coming to lead us this morning, Emily Smith. She's getting hugged by Mary Lee right now, if you wanted to find her. I spoke to Emily this morning. She's 27 years old. So when she was negative 2 in November of 1993, I was a very depressed, very lost 19-year-old boy. And on November 28, 1993, Jesus found me. And so that's what, 29 years ago, that I've been trying to follow the Lord. Any of you who have been following him for that long or longer know that sometimes you try and it doesn't work out really good, but you try to follow the Lord. Back in the 90s, there was a bracelet that a lot of us would wear. Anybody remember what that bracelet said on it? What would Jesus do? And the bad thing about that bracelet was, in most normal circumstances in life, I had no clue what Jesus would do. You say, well, just read the Bible. Well, what shoes would Jesus buy? Just in regular everyday things, I didn't know what Jesus would do. So that bracelet, the fad passed, and we moved on from that. But still in my life, I've wanted to do what Jesus would do. And I can tell you one thing that he would do. I know 100% certain that he gives. And so if we want to know what Jesus would do, we can join him in giving. And I do get excited about that because he doesn't need it. He doesn't need my money, right? We say, well, the light bills have to be paid. If God wants the lights on, he can turn the lights on without my money, right? But the deal is that he has a plan in this world, and he sees a guy like me who's made more mistakes than all of you put together, and he says, Josh, I want you to be a part of what I'm doing. So yes, when I give, I get excited about it. And it is time to give. Let's pray. It's all yours, Lord. Not just the money in our pockets. This service, this church, this building, the elements that came together to make the bricks that put this building together are all yours. They're not mine. They're not anybody who's been here longer than me. They're not the person who just walked in the door for the first time. They belong to you. And you weren't short of cash this morning when you woke up. You weren't wondering how the bills were going to get paid. You have all those answers. But you looked at a hopeless, lost, sinless, sinful people. And you said, come join me. Come be a part of my family. Come be a part of the work I'm doing here. Oh God, we are so honored to be able to give to you this morning. We do it with great joy, with great excitement, with great happiness. Because you gave everything for us. You gave everything so that a lost, depressed, wandering 19-year-old boy didn't have to be lost, depressed, and wandering anymore. Thank you, Jesus. This is Emily Smith. She is now negative two plus, too much math. I just met her this morning. I mean, we've probably spoke before, but we talked a little bit this morning. She made it clear to me that she is not here to entertain you. She's here to lead us in worship. So let's all stand together, join her as we sing to the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing a song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. I will worship Your holy name.
Thank you.
All right, keep standing and singing with us. I'm going to warn Silas in advance that you're going to have to do some skipping around on the lyrics. Thank you much.
Thank you, Emily. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, sound booth peeps. I love there. Thank you, thank you. Good job. Thank you, congregation, for allowing the Lord to speak to you and for you to worship Almighty God. You know, what's interesting about that song is, you know, sometimes people say, well, nothing about God is reckless. Absolutely, there's nothing reckless about God. But comparatively speaking, think about what He did to come after you. By the world sense, that would be reckless, wouldn't it? Because possibly we were living out of His will. We were doing something we shouldn't be doing. Maybe we're the 19-year-old, the minus two that Josh was talking about. And we're looking back and we're like, there's no way God should leave any 99 for me. Right? But He did. And He wants more and more people to be part of His family. This week, look for ways to share the love of God with our community, our neighbors, our family, our friends, and shout it out. Make it known of the love of God in your heart. Maybe, just maybe, it'll spread. And God will get all the glory. Pray with me as we get ready to dive in God's Word. Father, thank You for the needed, reckless love that You, on purpose, made possible coming after me. Thank You, in spite of my sin, Lord, You still love me. And thank You, Lord, that You never looked at any of us as someone not to go after. Oh, Lord, we have been unholy, we've been unrighteous, we have sinned like nobody's business. But You did leave Your throne room, and You came and dwelt among us. And because of Your ultimate sacrifice, we can experience the true love, true acceptance that comes from Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. So as we consider Your love, as we consider the words You're going to speak to us now, certainly receive all the glory. Speak to us loud and clear, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I might need this clicker. I might not. Make the boys' job and ladies' job a lot easier. Good morning. It's great to see you guys. Y'all hungry? A little bit? Hungry for God's Word or hungry for the food next door? How about both? I like that answer, and that answer will suffice today. So I will go ahead and tell you unashamedly after the service is over, we'll have a prayer time, and then we'll dismiss over there, and we're looking forward to fellowshipping with each other. I will say also, too, if you didn't bring anything, but you're like, you know what, I still want to go. The Lord did the deal with the fishes and the loaves, right? Don't you think He's going to make enough over here? I think He's going to do plenty, and you guys can help us out and eating and being part of that time of fellowship. But let's get to the main course now, and that's God's Word. So if you've got your Bibles, again, open to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians 3:17, and entitled the message this morning, Freedom. Pretty simple, nothing cute, freedom. 2 Corinthians 3:17, if you don't have your Bibles with you or your devices with you, if you're online, check that out. But also, we're here, got it on the screen here. Here's God's Word. Now the Lord is the Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Again, now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. What is freedom to you? What's freedom? Is freedom choice? Is it independence? When you look at the Greek word for freedom, actually, it's it says liberty. Liberty. Not enslaved. That's what freedom is all about. If you think about it, in America, we've had a pretty good example over several hundred years of what freedom might look like. When we look at the Bill of Rights, as we look at amendments to the Constitution, think about all the different freedoms that we have been blessed to have. Freedom of speech. Freedom of the press, freedom of religion, freedom to keep and bear arms, freedom of due process when it comes to the law, freedom to have a speedy trial, an impartial jury, freedom from involuntary servitude, that is slavery, Freedom to vote, no matter what race or sex that you are. Freedom for citizens 18 years and older to vote. Some of us used that right a couple weeks ago. Some of us did not. Those are just a few of those freedoms that we enjoy. Air Force Colonel Walter Hitchcock pointed out a few years ago, he coined this phrase, at least he's getting credit for it, freedom isn't free. It comes at a price, one we must determine to either accept or reject, embrace or refrain from embracing. Now, from a Christian standpoint, freedom means everything, but it came at an extreme cost, didn't it? Think about it. Because of God's grace and Jesus' birth, life, death, and resurrection, those that call upon His name no longer have to live in fear of condemnation. But rather, we can live our lives with joy and forgiveness. Joy and forgiveness. That is freedom, is it not? John 8:36 reminds us, so if the Son sets you free, what? You are free indeed. Author and teacher Steve Mills points out, freedom depends on what controls each of us. Each day, man makes a choice. We either are controlled by sin, controlled by his spirit, or controlled by his word. But being controlled by God's spirit and God's word requires something of us. It requires us to submit and yield our authority in favor of God's authority. The world wouldn't have us do that. The world would want us to submit to its desires, submit to our desires of the flesh. Ultimately, though, we have to choose. Do we accept God's teachings? Do we accept His instructions? Do we accept His decrees? Do we accept His commands? Do we accept the freedom that He offers us? Psalm 119:44-45. When we embrace Jesus' truth and apply it to our lives, He sets us free. John 8:32, Galatians 5:1. And being under God's control, compared to the control of the flesh, is the best type of freedom we could ever hope for. Romans 8:1-3. Now, this morning, we're going to continue our study of 2 Corinthians. What gave it away? The scripture? Yeah. We're going to continue that, and we're going to look at what type of freedom Paul was speaking about, though, to the church of Corinth. They were facing some stuff. They were facing some uncertainties, some challenges, and we're going to see the type of freedom that he was talking about there. We'll also determine what keeps us from experiencing that same type of freedom today. There may be some things that are clouding our vision that God's going to show us as we look at this passage of Scripture. Now, we have been looking at 2 Corinthians, and we have went through and kind of shared a few things that stand out about this particular book. But again, I'll highlight one. You can read from the screen, or you can squint and look at the screen, or you can go back and listen to the other services. But that being said, when it comes to 2 Corinthians for today, I want to highlight that one thing that was going on in the church of Corinth, one thing that was going on in the Corinthian people. Remember, there were some 400,000 people at this time in Corinthians. All right? The Corinthians, 400,000 folks, and of those 400,000 folks, two-thirds of them were in some capacity enslaved. That's a high population to be enslaved, right? And so there was a need, this population, to know what freedom looked like, what freedom tastes like, what freedom looked like specifically within the church. And I think we're going to see it in this passage this morning. It's going to come and even bring that into a higher focus. Those who are part of the Corinthian church, again, there was a division there. And somehow God was going to use what Paul was saying to bring them back under the fold. Last time, again, we determined why Paul's encouragement to the church of Corinth was so important. Paul had been accused of some false teachings, some false things, all kinds of different stuff. They were bringing him down. But he was encouraged to show sweet forgiveness to the congregation. Sometimes we need to show sweet forgiveness to the people we worship with, don't we? Amen? Because sometimes we might hold a grudge, might be frustrated at something. Shoot, it might even affect our worship if we don't forgive. And you might say, well, I got reason to be frustrated. I got reason to hold something on. And Paul had reason. They were bad-mouthing him. They were saying that he was an apostle of Jesus. They were saying that his truths were not exactly all true, and that he was trying to embrace himself and build himself up. And there was a lot of pompous arrogance going on with that. And Paul said, you know what? We're going to bring things back together. We're going to bring that division that I was telling you about, and we're going to bring it whole. And God's going to bring healing, and he chose to forgive. And we need to forgive no matter the circumstance we're facing now. You might be at work. Somebody's done you wrong. They talk bad about you. Now your job is even in jeopardy. Your family. You might have had a reputation, and now your reputation's been soiled. Kind of smells, kind of stinks, because of somebody within your own bloodline done tore you down. The church can do that too. But we have a choice. We have a decision to make. Do we forgive? Do we show that sweet forgiveness? Or do we hold a grudge? I love that Paul encourages the church to forgive. And we need to be reminded of that as well. In our workplace, in our time of worship, within our families, even the people we can't stand. People that get on our everlasting nerve. Some of y'all thinking about that everlasting nerve right now, aren't you? Amen? God wants us to forgive, and Paul reminded us of that. Now let's dive into chapter 3. And yes, we're going to look at all 18 verses, but we're not going to read every one of them. Your job is to go back and highlight. Your job is to underline. Your job is to let the Holy Spirit speak to you as we're preaching here, okay? So check it out. When you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul, again, is still engaged in a battle. It's a battle sometimes. Even within the church, you're like, Lord, I want to do this. Lord, I feel led to do that. Lord, I feel your hand, your touch. You're telling us to go this way. But then sometimes things get in the way. And Paul was feeling this battle. Again, persistence was going on within the false teachers. And they wanted to continue to see him trip up. They didn't want the church to be built up. They couldn't get out of their way, right? And so, again, Paul is going through this battle, and this counterfeit gospel that Warren Wiersbe talks about in his commentary is among the people. And that counterfeit gospel is this thing called mixture of law and mixture of grace. Mixture of law and mixture of grace. Now, we are called to do good works, right? I think that's in James. I think someone reminded me recently. James reminds us, you know, faith without works is what? It's dead. And I think it's great to have the law, but we're going to see how the law and grace, when they get so intertwined, it can get messy. Because God is saying, hey, we are going to need to usher in what we call a new covenant. And we're going to talk about the Old Covenant and the New Covenant here in just a minute. We're just going to touch on them a bit. But again, the division within this particular church, they were struggling with the law and with grace. And Paul's going to address those issues. But one of the other issues that you'll see in verse 1, that Paul jumps right out front and asks a couple questions that we kind of need to check out for ourselves as well. He is asking those reading this particular letter, are you commending yourselves? Are we commending ourselves? And do we need a letter of recommendation? The people that these were being addressed to, there was a desire, right? They wanted to catch Paul in somehow or another some act that he was lifting himself up, that he was commending himself, that he was putting himself above everybody else. I love my friend Mackie Turner, who has come and supplied here. He always likes to get down front. And one of the reasons he said that, he goes, you know, I'm no different than you. I want to be on an equal playing field. Now, that doesn't mean every pastor in the county or the country has to go and stand on the floor. I know some, if I got to walking on the floor, but if the Lord tells me to, guess what, I'm going to do it. But some of us don't like being so close to the pastor because we're afraid he might come over and tap us on the shoulder because we might be sleeping, right? We might get too close. We might, you know, preachers start talking and stuff comes out of their mouth. He's like, I don't want to get me a spit shield because he's talking so much, right? Some of y'all thought that. I just said it out loud. But again, these folks that were against Paul, against the church of Corinth, creating that even playing field, bringing that mended, broken relationship together, they wanted to keep that stirred up. And some of them, I'm sure they even meant well. But guess what was happening? It was tearing the church apart. And Paul, again, addresses those issues because some folks want to lift themselves up before God. They think they're bigger than God. They think they know better than God. And so they were attacking Paul and thinking he was commending himself and that he needed some letter of recommendation. I like having a letter of recommendation, don't you? When you go get a job, what do you put on an application, right? You put references. And you get that letter of recommendation. That sometimes pushes you over the edge. That gives you the opportunity that someone else could not have afforded. But as Paul reminds those that read the passage of Scripture here, Paul's preaching salvation through Christ. Paul is sharing the good news, not only to Corinth and Ephesus and all the different places that he would go. He was preaching Christ and Christ alone. That's the only letter of recommendation. That is the only thing that he needed to go. So many times we get caught up in so many different things that, quote unquote, make someone qualified to do a job. The only qualification is that Jesus met Saul, who would become Paul, and took this little man and used him to spread out his kingdom. So the church of Corinth and these false teachers who were trying to preach everything else except that, they were kind of stumped. And these were learned men too. Most of them, they knew what they knew because they had studied it. When you look at the old covenant of the law, I mean, there's some good stuff there. So preaching about the old covenant, preaching about what God's commands are, that's not such a bad thing, is it? But this new covenant, this grace that was being talked about, actually supersized. It was superior to the old covenant. And because of that superiority, that grace that came in changed hearts. The law is perfect. The law is good. It does point you and I to a need for a Savior. But the law does not save. Grace saves. Jesus saves. And so that's a whole different ball game. And so, again, as Paul is preaching and sharing 2 Corinthians 3, 4 through 6, we see that he's not interested in the approval of men. The day that I looked for someone else to scratch my ears and tell me how good I am is the day I need to walk out these doors. Because I didn't come to preach to satisfy everybody. I'm preaching because I feel God's put a message in my heart. I feel there's a call that he's put on my life. And I want to share the good news. I want to see people saved. I want to see a growing fellowship that wants to be discipled and to be loved and show love to this community. And there'll be a day if he ever calls me away, it'll be because I want it because he's called me, not because the message that I was sharing was something that too many itching ears couldn't handle. Paul was not all about that. And it took a boldness there to just share the good news. Because we all are proud, aren't we? I'm proud. Are you proud? I like my accomplishments. You like your accomplishments. I like having my ribbons, you know, on my chest. And I like having my stuff on the board. And I like having that picture frame. And I go, look, you see what I did? You see that? It was beautiful. I like looking at my stuff. It's okay that we have the accomplishments. It's okay that we do cool things. But it should never overshadow the dependence that we have on Christ. God has to remind us sometimes, he does, that he can use anybody he wants to point others to his saving grace. And that's how Paul was approaching this. Now, as we look at verses 7 through 18, I hope I'm not jumping around too much. Am I jumping around too much? Are you still with me? Staying with me? Okay, all right, good. Moving on to verses 7 through 18, Paul continues to describe the greater, verse 11. The ministry of the Spirit, the freedom that is available to those who choose Christ compared to the law. There's freedom there. There's freedom. Make no mistake. Again, the law is good. It's perfect. It pointed everyone to their need for a Savior, their issues with sin. But the law did not save, and we needed a Savior. And with that new covenant, the Savior was Jesus, and he ministers in a time of grace, a time of grace that you and I get to afford ourselves today. But sometimes the history of those that were reading and hearing this letter, maybe if they were like the Israelites back in Moses' day, they had issue with that. Think about the time of Exodus chapter 34 when Moses was delivering the people of Israel. What was going on there? Moses, because of God's glory that was shown to him when he talked with God, there was a presence that occurred that you look at the very face of Moses and you could tell he had been in the presence of God. And this kind of tripped folks out, right? Because they didn't want to see his face. As a matter of fact, Moses would veil his face so that he could basically hide that glory that was shown on his face. So when he wasn't in the presence, they couldn't tell how long it has been because his face had been so bright and so shining, right? That he had a veil to kind of hide that. I don't know about you, when you could come in contact with individuals that have such a loving spirit, do you see a certain brightness about them? Do you? Can you tell those folks that have a love of Jesus or a love of people, do they just have a certain smile about them? It just radiates. It permeates everything. You know that? And that's kind of what was going on with Moses, right? But he kept his face veiled and covered. But when Jesus died for our sins, grace was made available, and that veil was removed. In the old covenant, we had the veil covering Moses, right? So the folks didn't see that. But now, because of grace coming in, it's like Moses' veil could be removed. Because it was no longer the law that was putting things and holding things together. The people now have hope. 2 Corinthians 3:12, they could boldly come before the throne and not have to hide their faces in shame. Sometimes when you wear a veil, it's when a wedding day occurs and the bride is kind of holding back the grand finale when you go, hey, what's going on? I love that. Hey, we saw Father the Bride last night. We were watching a cheesy 90s movie. And if you haven't been to some cheesy 90s movies like Father the Bride, hey, rent that one, okay? But she had the veil down, and then when the veil was lifted up, it's like, oh, look how beautiful. How beautiful is God's grace. How beautiful it is that He is not hidden from us, that He has tore the veil. He tore the curtain in the temple. You and I have been freed because of grace, God's grace. Now they could boldly come before the throne. And yes, we are still going to sin, but the power over sin has now been realized. Whenever anyone turns to Christ, that veil is taken away. Some of us might feel we're never worthy to be in the presence of God. We're never going to have enough forgiveness. He's never going to forgive us for enough of the bad stuff that we did that He would even face us. But when you and I accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, that veil is removed. He reveals Himself to you, and grace begins to abound. When everyone turns to Christ, that freedom in verse 17, that liberty transforms our hearts, and it transforms us too. We, like Moses, the reference in the other verses of this chapter, we're changed too. We have a different outlook. We might still, again, fall short. We're going to fall short. That's going to happen. But we're now living not by the flesh, but we're living by the Spirit. And that was going to change everything. Such hope comes from the new covenant found in Jesus. God makes us holy. He makes us righteous. He provides the ultimate antidote for our sin problem. We're never going to go and get enough COVID-19 shots to get rid of that disease. We're never going to go to enough doctor's appointments and get enough treatments to get rid of that issue called sin. It took Jesus. It took His blood being shed for you and me, for us to be made right before the Father. When embracing His grace, our spiritual vision is no longer impaired, but rather repaired. Some of us need some repair today. Sometimes we think that repairs are more done like on automobiles. Well, I need a new muffler so that it doesn't sound like a Sherman tank going through the neighborhood, okay? Well, you know, my pistons are banging up against the engine block. I need to get an oil change so that can run smoother. Sometimes we think those kind of the repairs we think of. But some of us need some repairs this morning. We've forgotten who it is that we serve. We forgot who it is that brought us grace and love and acceptance. We've been so concentrating, again, on a law that is perfect, a law that is right, that we forgot that the grace giver, Jesus, has come to save our soul. We need that message again today, and the church of Corinth needed it as well. The church of Corinth needed reminding that their commending and their praising could be pointed only to one, not to their accommodations on a wall, not to all the good stuff that they were doing, but rather to the one true King who is Christ. And the greatest credential offered by God removed that sin for both Jew and Gentile, and it came through the only name who is Jesus. So, what's that mean to us today? Why is that important? What about the Church of Corinth's freedom experience should cause me to stop, take inventory of where I am in my relationship with God? Where are my eyes veiled today? Where are they covered? What keeps me from seeing what God wants me to see? Got one thing to share with you. What keeps us from seeing God's image in our lives today? The reality of sin that can enter in. The reality of sin that can enter in. When we embrace God's new covenant, we embrace the grace of Jesus. As already stated, the law is perfect, points out our need for a Savior. But because of Jesus, no longer are we held back by the condemning truth of the law. Without Jesus, eternal death was our final destination. That was it. But when we put our eyes on Him, when He showed us grace, He gave us life. And that payment of sin was finished on the cross of Calvary. Jesus didn't come to nullify the law, but rather to foretell the law, Matthew 5:18. Because of the need for a perfect sacrifice and eternal freedom to be realized, Jesus had to lay down His life and supply that unfailing grace. We didn't deserve His sacrifice. We deserve condemnation. We all fall short of the glory of God. But He superseded the law, and grace would abound. Grace would be found in our hearts when we accept Him and Lord as Savior of our lives. Because of Christ, God the Father doesn't look at our sin the same. God doesn't look at us the same. God the Father sees Jesus in our place. No longer are you condemned. No longer are you defined by your worst sin, your worst experience. It's because of Jesus and the grace that He's brought to you that we have hope. Again, the reality is our vision gets blurred from time to time. We're focusing on other things. As we walk with the Lord, we sometimes forget about grace. We're all about the mistakes that we make. Sometimes, instead of looking in the mirror to see Jesus, we still manage to see more of ourselves and the sin that we've experienced. During this sanctification process, we are still going to make mistakes, and we need to confess those sins that come our way. Again, it doesn't mean that we're not going to sin. But we can always hold on to the fact that our salvation is secure in Christ because of the grace He has sent us. Paul saw Jesus in himself. Paul saw Jesus in himself not because He had arrived, but rather because the Holy Spirit was dwelling in him and directing his path. The church of Corinth needed to get their eyes off of themselves. We, the church today, not just Oak Grove, we, the church, the body of Christ, need to get our eyes off of ourselves today. Because that leads us astray. We want to stay the course that Christ has played out for us so that we might remember His grace and ultimately remember the freedom we have in Him. The Son has set you free. So what? We are free indeed. Paul had that message for the church of Corinth. And I believe God's got that message today. As we conclude this part of the service, I'll just ask you a simple question. How clearly do you and I see the image of God in our lives? How clearly is it? Is there anything blurring your vision and seeing God? Is there anything that we're putting ahead of him, hurting our fellowship? Now, for a non-believer, guess what? There's never going to be enough things that you're going to do, enough laws that you're going to keep to enter and be accepted into the kingdom of God. Can I tell you that? You're never going to be perfect enough, all right? So it's going to take you inviting Christ, who has identified your sin in your life, and it's going to take you admitting that you're a sinner, confessing that sin, and inviting him to be your Lord and Savior. That's the only way that you're going to see clearly God's plan for you. That your veil, non-believer, is going to be removed once and for all. That you experience the grace that Christ has for you. If you'll do that this morning, yes, you're going to still trip up. Yes, you're still going to fall. But you'll find out what it truly means to be accepted today. And for you, Christian, who has been walking with the Lord for some time, maybe you've gotten a little bit blurred with your vision because you've got your eyes focused on not the most important thing. Maybe we've gotten so caught up on, yes, it's great for us to follow God's character and his attributes, and we need to do the things that God wants us to do, but maybe we've been concentrated on so much of the law that we forgot about grace and how to show grace to our fellow believers. This morning, Jesus wants to have an appointment with you. He wants to put you back on the right path. Freedom awaits. Don't go it alone. Allow him to bring freedom to your heart and soul today. In a moment, we're going to have a song of reflection. What is that all about? Well, song of reflection is simply that. There's a message God had for you. Maybe it was in a song. Maybe it was in a prayer. Maybe it was in the message that God brought from his word today. What are you going to do with that? Is it going to stay there in the pew? Is it going to turn into a time of prayer at this altar? Is it going to change your drive home? Is it going to change your devotion time this week? Is it going to change how you interact with people? How you extend grace and love to others this week? I don't know. But I know God wants us to respond as he leads. So as we sing Only Trust Him, will you do that today? Trust him and your response to his word, and trust him with your life. Because when you do, freedom will reign in your heart. Grace will abound in your soul. The new life that you want is available to you if you'll trust him. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, as you come and you lead us as time of reflection, Father, you forgive me where I've not represented your word in the way that it should be represented. But in spite of my failed attempts to teach your word this morning, will you take what was heard, what was delivered, will you take your word that never returns null and void, and may you remind each and every one of us that freedom awaits those that trust Christ. Someone needs the freedom to be unlocked this morning. As we respond through song, help us to tap into your strength, rest in your grace, and put our hope in you. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please stand as we sing together. Josh? For those in Christ, aren't you glad He saved you? Amen? Amen? That's something we should shout about. Shout about worshiping through giving. We should shout about God saving our souls and being there with us, that we can trust Him and that we have freedom in His grace. Amen?
Amen.
Oh, that's something to celebrate. That's something to celebrate. So glad to be with you at the house of the Lord today. I know that I'm not Paul, and Mike's not Paul, and so Paul's not here today, but I can do a couple of